The thoughts and opinions of this program are simply those, or merely those, or whatever those, of the hosts and the guests of the program, or whoever really cares. It's the good, the bad, and the rooster.
You had a bad weekend or something? Good Lord.
I'm Jimmy Olsen with Rooster McRoberts. Nah, I don't know. How was your weekend? It wasn't too bad.
No, actually, it was very, very relaxing. Of course, Thursday being Thanksgiving, I had my 83-year-old mother over. Kids up in Minnesota had Thanksgiving by themselves. The kids down here in Des Moines took the whole family and went to Branson.
Oh, wow.
Thanksgiving and just had a bang-up time.
Well, that's nice.
They enjoyed that. We just had a nice... Ms. McRoberts, my mom and I just had a nice dinner on Thursday, relaxed, great conversation. And then, you know, sit around, watch TV a little bit. Nothing big. Then Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
All leftovers.
Which I got to tell you, I love leftovers.
Well, that was going to be
turkey
my next...
That
was going to be my next question. So what do you do? Because, I mean, now after Thanksgiving, depending on how big of a turkey you had and how much was left over, what all do you do with turkey leftovers?
Are you just a
one-trick pony, or do you try to find different things to do with the leftover turkey?
Chef salad with turkey.
Okay.
Awesome. Right. Awesome. In the middle of night, when you need a snack, a little bit of turkey. Just to nip it out of the bowl, you know, that you got covered over. Just eat it plain with nothing on it. Love it with turkey sandwiches with mustard. I'm not a one-trick pony, but that's probably the three ways that I like it the best.
So you don't take some of it, like maybe make a turkey chili or a turkey soup. Because, you know, there's some people that they really come up with different things.
Yeah, I love that.
Maybe a casserole that you throw the turkey in.
And I would certainly do it, but we don't do it at our house. Mrs. McRoberts is not a major turkey fan, but she likes turkey, but she's not a major turkey fan. I'll pick at that thing for several days. Then obviously, guess what? Miss Tilly in the backyard gets it, you know, at that point.
Well, a friend of mine, they actually do it's a sandwich, and I think they said that it was something that JFK, it was his favorite for like the leftovers, I could be wrong.
It was the
turkey, dressing, stuffing, you know, whatever you call it in your home, the cranberry sauce, you know, in between bread or rolls or whatever. And that's what they do with that's what he does with his leftovers.
Yeah. I mean, you know, everybody's got unique ways of doing it, but at the end of the day, I really don't like turkey. You know, like you can get a turkey sandwich at Subway or someplace like plug there, send me $1 million. you know, one of those places, it just doesn't taste the same to me as doing it in your own kitchen, baking it in your own oven, whatever the heck you do with it, or deep fat frying it in your backyard, you know, the way that we do it sometimes and others do also. Or smoke it.
I say my daughter smoked it, which
I think that's great.
I went there on Friday. She
it's
had
tough
hers,
to roll,
and it was
yeah,
good.
That's good. Hard to roll, but but you know, there's different ways of doing it. But I don't. But right now around Thanksgiving, and if we do a turkey around Christmas, okay, we don't do the Christmas goose. Any of you that have ever had a goose understand that it is a oily, slimy bird to eat. I realize probably some people know how to
I mean, you'll do roast.
Oh, yeah, for, you know, yeah. Roast is great.
Actually, what we did, I mean, when I was growing up, we would have turkey and ham on Thanksgiving and on Christmas.
A lot
of it was the Christmas ham.
Yep. Well, now, we had ham, too. I forgot about that. We had a ham, too.
Bone in or just
No. Okay. We went ahead and got one that's already cut up. Now, sometimes if we have a large group, there's a company in town here that does what's called a spiral cut hams. Now, you can probably buy them at Walmart. Again, plug Walmart, $1 million. The local company, don't worry, I want to do that just for you because I love you. The fact is, the spiral cut hams are awesome.
Right.
I mean, those are just absolutely awesome. When I go back down home, Tennessee, Kentucky, Tennessee, get up in the Tennessee mountains, I'm going to tell you what, year round. I mean, they got hams that they've cured and hanging them out. I mean, and I like. Old fashioned style ham that tastes real salty because of the way that they've preserved it. Now, that to me is my favorite. And then there with the ham, you got ham sandwiches, you got ham and beans, mm-hmm. and you got ham and eggs in the morning. You know, I mean, kind of like going to Cracker Barrel. $1 million, check me out. Cracker Barrel, I always order the country, what they call country ham.
Right.
Okay,
right.
Generally has
I've
the
had
bone
it before. Yeah.
Awesome stuff. Matter of fact, I'm hungry. Let's go. All right, go ahead.
You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home or business finances on autopilot. DebtProdigy.com to get the details along. Well, of course, we've been talking Thanksgiving with a lot of good things, but some
sure.
sad news.
Yes.
Florence Henderson from the Brady Bunch. She actually was found died of heart failure on. She was found on Thanksgiving.
She's 82 years of age.
Yeah.
Last time I saw her on TV, I mean, look, I don't know Florence Henderson from A Load of Bricks, but you know, it's kind of like
she just kind of still looks like mom, but older.
Yeah,
I mean,
she never really changed a lot. But she never got old.
Right.
At least she did a great job troweling on the makeup, obviously. But, I mean, she really never looked old to me.
Well, what was interesting is 3 days before that she died, she was at a taping for Dancing with the Stars.
Yeah, there you go.
And then 3 days later, boom. I mean, it was just, you know.
You don't know. You just don't know. Mm-hmm. I mean, you just don't know. And, she, you know, I had a cousin over in London.
Mm-hmm.
Five stints in one day, 2-3 weeks ago, mm-hmm. you know. You just don't know. Now,
no.
In her case, she's in great shape. In my cousin's case, hey, bud, you need to learn to back away from the table and start walking. Your wife marathon runs. You need to do the same thing.
Right.
Work your way up to that. So you just don't know. And
no,
it is sad because she became a household name
mm-hmm.
and an institution.
Right.
Back in the days, in my opinion, and my opinion's always right, when TV shows generally had a moral to the story.
Right. Well, no, there was. I mean, you had them, the Partridge Family.
Absolutely. There was a moral.
The Monkeys back in the 60s. You're right.
There was a moral to their stories. The storylines by the writers took you around and gave you some great entertainment, and you laughed at it.
Well, it was a family show for the kids. I mean, you watched it with the family to learn that.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah, you know, the only...
there's cartoons in the 80s that did the same type of thing.
Absolutely, yeah. But I never watched cartoons. I really didn't. Seriously, I was never a cartoon guy.
Like
a video game guy. Never that, but we're getting off the subject. let me tell you, I do want another plug, $1 million, please. Hallmark, in my opinion,
mm-hmm.
they always do their special movies during the course of the year.
The Hallmark Channel.
Hallmark Channel, the Hallmark holiday movies that they mm-hmm. put out. I don't, you know, look, I'm not into all this sappy, syrupy, you know, chick flick stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But let me tell you, it's quality.
Right.
Kansas City, Missouri, Hallmark. $1 million anytime you send the check, is clearly a company that knows how to do a movie that sends a clear, moral, ethical message to the community. And I think that every school should watch Hallmarks. I mean, I'm serious. They do a good job.
Well,
that's my point.
As you say that, I mean, as I think of even shows that I watch today and shows that I've watched, you know, back then, you're absolutely right. I mean, even going to like WKRP in Cincinnati, which I grew up watching that, there
sure.
was not every one, but there were ones that every once in a while they would have the,
sure.
that there was some moral, they did this, you know, or they were, and then of course I remember in the 80s, the after school specials, you had a lot of that. I
absolutely.
Mean, dealing with bullying, dealing with lying, dealing with stealing. I mean, whatever it was, there was something. And you watch the shows today, I mean, they're just kind of there. I mean, there's no real reason to pull the family together.
Yeah, let me give
not
you,
saying they're bad, but...
Well, you know, it also gets to the message,
right.
Okay? Let's face it. I mean, when Friends came out, you had six people there, none of them had a damn job, or at least they didn't go to a job. They spent more of their time in a coffee shop than they did a job. And I understand Ross was a paleontologist.
They were, they had jobs. They just never showed them going at the job.
That's exactly right. To me, it was a misrepresentation of life.
It was kind of like Seinfeld. I mean, it was kind of the same.
That's clearly a misrepresentation of life.
But anyway, well, you mentioned Friends. I mean, here's another thing. You know, they always say they come in threes. Ron Glass, if you remember him from Barney Miller.
Yep.
He was the Preacher in Firefly. He also passed over the weekend. He was in Friends as a divorce lawyer, Ross's divorce lawyer for
I'm trying to remember what that guy looked like.
He was like tall, slender, I don't remember him never having a mustache, but he was the taller, slender black guy from Barney Miller.
Okay.
Great guy, great actor.
71. Yeah. He was a good actor. I mean, mm-hmm. He did a great job.
He ended up with a lot of bit parts of things like Friends and other TV shows, you know, there towards later on.
He's a great supporting actor in TV and TV in particular.
Right,
okay.
Exactly.
71. Okay.
And then, of course, we'll cover this a little more, too, but Fidel Castro also died over the weekend, too, which I know Rooster's got a few things to discuss about that, which it's kind of interesting, the two different sides that people are taking with his death, but we'll cover that here.
Yeah, you tell me when, I'll roll.
Exactly. What's your favorite? So we're past Thanksgiving, which is, as I think we talked about last week, is what I call the entry level drug for Christmas. You know,
it is the gateway. You used the term last week as gateway drug for Christmas. Yes.
So now you've got different radio stations, even a lot of online stations, the Christmas songs. What's your favorite Christmas song?
White Christmas.
White Christmas?
Yeah, it truly is the White Christmas.
Have you seen the movie?
White Christmas?
Yeah. I'm just asking. Seriously, dude, I'm
a old fart.
That doesn't mean anything. I did not see it until just a couple of years ago. Honestly.
Really?
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
I mean, I heard about it. I knew it until it ended up on Netflix and it popped up. I finally watched it.
I mean, you're talking about Bing Crosby, right. Danny Kaye,
right.
Rosemary Clooney. I mean,
And I grew up watching I grew up watching Danny Kaye movies. I grew up
Absolutely.
Watching all that stuff. And for whatever reason, I never saw
White Christmas. And then the second one. Since we're asking, top one and two for Roosters,
sure.
It's White Christmas and It's a Wonderful Life.
Which both great.
And then you could probably add Miracle on 34th Street as the third one. But you notice something about that?
Mm-hmm.
And I think if you polled anybody, unless they start pulling out Hallmark movies.
Right.
Because Hallmark, again, has, in my opinion, continued that great legacy of quality holiday movies, like those first three I mentioned.
Right.
I mean, and we're talking about all three had a message.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, It's a Wonderful Life, clearly a great message.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. White Christmas, hugely entertaining, but the message that I got, and I'm sure somebody going, well, that's not the message I got. I got this message.
Whatever.
You know, they're a bunch of white supremacists because they talk about White Christmas. Kiss my ass. Anyway, that just popped in my head and I thought I'd add that. I mean, here's the thing. I mean, seriously, what we're doing here, we're sitting here And people, I'm changing the subject. Anyway, White Christmas is my number one movie. I think it rocked. I think it was wonderful.
Okay.
I love musicals. I know, I'm not going to use that word because I'm going to get my butt kicked, but I love musicals. I always have.
So here's how we're going to end this with the
yeah, please
one.
End it because I want to say something. I want to blurt something out in just a minute.
Number one, the most downloaded Christmas song right now is Mariah Carey's All I Want for Christmas Is You. That's like the number one downloaded song. In that top 10, it includes a couple songs from Trans-Siberian Orchestra, Christmas Eve, Sarajevo, also the Christmas Canon, Rockin' Around the Christmas Tree, Brenda Lee.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Where Are You Christmas, Faith Hill, Jose Feliciano, Feliz Navidad, of course, Bobby Helms, Jingle Bell Rock, which almost any movie that's made around Christmas, I mean, even Lethal Weapon.
Jingle
which
Bell.
Was it was a Christmas
it movie.
Movie. It opened the movie that way.
That's exactly
that would be
it.
For me, my favorite two Christmas movies would be Lethal Weapon and Die Hard.
That's hilarious, which I like both of those movies.
But okay, so here
clearly did not send a message on being more anyway. But great again, entertainment.
Exactly. Okay, so what does White Christmas mean?
It means all my brother white people, we in control. Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay, so
did I go the wrong direction?
So what
there?
I mean, because and there's two different ways that I've heard this.
Oh, well, I'll give you my way. I'll be serious.
So what does White Christmas mean to you?
I think that what I've always, and it has been a few years since I watched it, but I can almost
no. I'm not talking about the movie. I'm just saying if
what's
someone
the term
says,
White Christmas?
Oh, what does it mean? This is the term.
What it means to me,
yeah,
is that Christmas is not Christmas unless you have snow on the ground.
Okay.
Snow in the trees, that type of thing.
Now, is it waking up to snow on the ground or waking up to the snow fall? No, and that's honestly the two ways that I've heard the definition of a white Christmas, that is one being waking up to snow being on the ground, and of course it's the fresh fallen. That's why it's white before, you know, all the dirt and that.
Right.
But then I've also heard that the white Christmas is getting up, and it is like in some of the Norman Rockwell and a lot of
I guess
pictures,
my definition would be
picture.
I have enough snow on the ground where it looks nice, but during the night.
So it
there's been a
while
nice yeah while I'm sleeping there's okay. a nice coat that cleans up all the mess from the previous snow.
Sure.
And when I get up, what I want to see on a white Christmas is these big, fat, gorgeous snowflakes dropping from the sky while I'm sitting there drinking coffee or hot chocolate with a little nip in it and with my family. That's to me, that's what it means by white Christmas.
So again, I was just curious because, like I said, you've got the two different ones, and it, you know, it's, and I know you can always Google it to find out what the true one is, but you know, it's more to me, Christmas is personal. It's really what it is that touches me, that gets me through the holidays with family and things like that. I mean, I find Christmas out of most any holiday being one of the more personal type holidays. I mean, I could be wrong, but that's just the way I think about it. But anyway.
Oh, no, that's okay. Yeah. I don't think there's a right or wrong answer other than that stupid remark I made 4 minutes ago. look, seriously, somebody's probably going to come out and pick at my front yard for that. Fine. You try. We'll see where you go from there.
You're listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy, they help track all your spending and expenses, create and manage your budget, manage all your financial account, and Debt Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time.
Can I interject something? I'm sorry, bud. Can I interject something about Debt Prodigy? Mm-hmm. Believe it or not. Yes, this is Ripley's. Believe it or not. Okay?
And we're not in Branson.
Yeah, well, they're all over, but yeah. If you've been to one, you've been to them all, by the way.
I've only been to the, believe it or not, museum in Branson, which it was really cool.
It's cool. I mean, the largest ball of twine, I really needed to see that. My life would never have been complete without seeing a 10-ton ball of twine. I would rather meet the idiot that did it, okay? That, to me, would have been much more interesting because I go and go, dude, really, seriously, are you on drugs or what, you know? But when it comes to what the heck was I talking about?
Anyway, Debt Prodigy.
Oh, Debt Prodigy. Thank you very much. See, that's why we're a team. We're almost like a married couple. If I can't finish it, he does. Okay, here's the deal. What was it again? Oh, it's Debt Prodigy. Yeah, okay, I'm back with it. Okay, so here's the thing. I just got notified over the weekend from Sean and Nathan that we are within a short few weeks of launching. I'm serious. A short few weeks of launching. And I don't care what you see on TV about this program and it's free and that program and it's free. It will not. They will not. Cannot do what this powerful program will do for what, around $15-$20 a month. I'm telling you, folks, it is unflipping believable. And I looked at what's on the slate to even improve that program over the next 6 to 12 months, and it blew me away. I can tell you this, and no disrespect to this person I'm about to mention. You can take the Dave Ramseys of the world, and they'll teach you how to get out of debt. You got to do it on a notepad. But at the end of the day, once you're out of debt, you get yourself back into debt. And I know they've polled people that have done that. It works, but once they're out of debt at 8, 9, 10, 12 years, and they're in their 40s or 50s, they still need another car. They haven't saved anything for vacations. So what do they do? Oh boy, credit card time comes, Christmas comes, but credit card time's come, new car, and they mortgage up to the hilt to stay current. And guess what? They're in the same boat again and going back to and paying for another class for a guy like Dave Ramsey, or there's several other ones that are out there. Here's my point, folks. Here's my point for you two that are listening. My point here is that if you sign up, debtprodigy.com, sign up, pre-register, and are on that list, you're going to get the first month free. This is what the guys told me. And you are going to have the most powerful financial tool that's ever been devised or developed. And you will have money. When you're out of debt, guess what? You're going to have a bank of money. If you need to go buy a new car, you need to go to the banker. Guess who the banker is? It's going to be you, because you are going to borrow from yourself rather than give it to a financial institution and let them drag you over the coals with costs, so on and so forth. Having said all that, that's my position.
Debt.
Thank you for your time.
Com. All right, so did you make it out at all for Black Friday?
Absolutely, unequivocally, no, and hell no.
So there were two people that were actually that died Black Friday in New Jersey. You had two that were dead, four hospitalized, and one guy used his belt as a whip.
Holy crap.
Exactly.
I mean, holy. I mean, I don't even know where you take that subject. I will point something out.
Well, a friend of mine actually said something about, you know, oh, things are, this is funny. We'll see if you agree with me here. They're saying, oh my gosh, things are getting worse. Black Friday's getting out of hand. They're, you know, because I heard some, you know, somebody shot someone in a parking lot. I mean, just whatever the reason being. And I'm sitting here going, oh yeah, it's terrible. And then again, I go, but we're not really in any different position now than what we were in the old West. They'd shoot you for your boots.
Yeah, I think it's different, just, though. I think
well, it's different now because we hear about it faster because of media and the internet.
I'm over here shaking. Can you see me through the microphone? I'm shaking my head.
In other words, what I'm saying is what is happening in here, it's nothing new. It's been happening for
years.
That's what I'm saying.
I will buy that. However, not Wall Street. Wall Street. Wall Street too.
Okay.
But Madison Avenue. We used to have a saying. You know, Madison Avenue is the culprit for everybody wanting to be like the Joneses, because they knew how to develop ads that you would go, you really didn't need that product, but I got to have that product.
Which actually was true. There was a family named Jones that people, I think we talked about that.
Yep. Anyway. I want to be like the Joneses. Now, I am disagreeing with Reverend Jim vehemently. Has there always been at gunpoint or beating somebody up to get stuff? You bet. There were highwaymen back in the old West. They were to get their stuff. And Black Friday, it was Black Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Well, I'm not talking about robbers. I'm just saying through history.
No. Okay. And here's the reason. It was back in the 70s or 80s. And again, I'm sure somebody will correct me if I'm wrong. One of you two listeners, do that for me, will you? But it was 70s or 80s. We noticed a change in the trend of stores being open. Jimmy, you're old enough to remember that nothing, not a gas station, or back in those days we called them filling stations, not a store. The bars were open, obviously, which is great, wonderful. But never, and even then, you know what? I remember even then they were closed. Nothing was open on Sunday. Okay?
Okay.
So the first problem is Wall Street, Madison Avenue, whatever, and the owners of businesses, the greed factor starts setting in. When we started saying, yeah, we'll sell everything, everybody's open on Sunday. Then, again, in a marketing ploy that, in my opinion, has imploded individuals' morals, individuals being able to handle themselves and self-control, is when they began Black Friday. And I'll be a son of a gun. I can't remember the name of the businesses, but there were several large chains that, if you check this out, Jimmy, guess what they did on Black Friday? They remained closed.
Well,
just because.
Well, there were some this year because they, you know, last year, the last couple of years, they started opening on Thanksgiving.
Yeah, they closed on Thanksgiving.
Maybe that
was it. No. It was Thanksgiving. My apologies.
And now this year, there were some, even some major retailers that said, you know, we did this and it really didn't move the needle for us. So, but then here's the other thing, though. You know, the trend of whole Black Friday, it's moving to more of the Cyber Monday.
Yeah, which means we're not pounding each other over the head to get the toy.
They're actually seeing a trend that they're saying that this year Cyber Monday will outsell Black Friday.
Then get rid of Black Friday.
Well, at some point it probably will, because everybody's going to go online.
Look, here's, you want to know something else?
What?
again, it's a ploy. And for you fools that buy into it and sit outside and wait 6 and 10 hours to be the first little sucker that walks through the door, you're fools.
Well, I was reading some of the deals with the exact, like the doorbuster specials. They're the same ones every year.
That's my point.
And there's some deals that it's really not the best deal that you can get throughout the year,
that's
which we've talked about before.
That's additionally right. My point. Do you think that sales are going to go down over the holidays if they don't have a Black Friday? The answer to that is absolutely not. I don't have any scientific numbers or scientific analysis of it, but I can tell you, if you need that TV and it's basically the same price you got during the course of the year, guess what? You're going to go buy that TV. Have your deals, that each of you stores, have your specials, run your specials. You that want to take advantage of the specials, don't be stupid. Frank, let me rephrase that. Don't be gullible. Don't take a $200 item, okay, mark it up to $250, and take 10% off and think you got a deal. Did you hear what I said? Don't take a $200 item and see the store mark it up to $250 during the holidays, price and demand, okay, demand is high, and then they give you a 10% discount, okay, which is $25. Mm-hmm. And you go, oh my God, I'm saving 10%, $25. That's a lot of money. I can buy a lot of McDonald's with that, and I can get fatter with that. Boy, I need to do that. You dummy. You just paid $25 more than what you could have bought it on any other day during the course of the year. And if you don't think that happens, you really are dumb.
I actually remember people talking to me was it my grandma? Someone, you know, when they were younger and they were working at stores, and that's what they did.
Yep.
They talked about things getting marked up the week before the big sale.
Yep.
And then the sale happened, and then basically it was either a little more or the sale price was what the price was a week ago.
Didn't change anything.
Yeah. Anyway, you're listening to The Good, the Bad, the Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home or business finances on autopilot, debtprodigy.com. I've got something, Rooster, to make you laugh.
Please do. I need a laugh.
This happened. I don't know. Did you hear about the Chipotle that was robbed right here in Des Moines?
The one in the mall?
Last week, the one right here in Des Moines, the Chipotle had was held up. Robber came in last week to take the money, and the cashier panicked, ran to the back room.
I heard it, but I didn't read it.
So the guy ended up with no cash, but he did take a burrito.
Okay, that's hilarious. So that they're in that little old employee's. In a dangerous, scary situation.
Just ran in the back room.
There's two things that will happen. Mm-hmm. It's called fight or flight. And flight won out here, okay? And that poor little sucker, probably kid, probably young person. Right. And that's, you know what, I don't blame, to tell you the truth, mm-hmm. I don't blame them. Now, I believe that they're taught, it is a funny story. Sad that somebody did that.
I just thought it was funny because he went back. Yeah, he took a burrito, but he ended up getting no money. Yeah, no, that's the funny part.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. It's hilarious. You know, that's on the Darwin list of dumb things. but I mean, seriously, I think they're taught. I heard someplace that employees at convenience stores, fast food restaurants, If somebody comes in to rob you, you are not to do anything but open up the drawers and hand them the dadgum money.
Yeah, they said that your life is not worth more than the money that's in the drawer.
That's exactly right. And they all have insurance. Mm-hmm. I mean, these companies, I mean, if they don't, that's silly. But definitely the franchises have money. So if they lose $10,000, they have insurance that will get that money back. They're not losing a dime, which then tells the criminals, go, well, then I'm not hurting anybody. They'll just get more. Well,
but then you're going to have some. I mean, there's always going to be that one that's behind the register that they're not going to do it. They're going to
be Rambo.
The hero.
They're going to be Rambo.
I mean, it's
being Rambo. Look, I carry a gun every day. Mm-hmm. I do not want to be a hero. I carry a gun every day. If something happens, I pray that I'll stand my ground. Mm-hmm. Okay. But at the end of the day, I hope I go to my grave and they bury me with my gun and I've never had to pull the trigger. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what I pray for. I do not need to be famous. Mm-hmm. And I clearly don't need to be famous laying in my coffin. Okay? So I mean, yeah, I just give them the money. Do not fight. You ain't Dirty Harry, okay? You're none of that. So
Exactly.
Now, if your life is threatened, I'm going for the 12 gauge.
If they have one. At the bar.
Yeah, well.
You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy. Debt Prodigy helps you track all of your spending and expenses, create and manage your budget, manage all your financial account. At Debt Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time. DebtProdigy.com. Okay, so full circle. We'll go back to we're talking about Fidel Castro, who had died over the weekend. And it's interesting, the two different sides that I'm seeing here. I mean, those of us in school, you know, I mean, we remember the Bay of Pigs, remember the very
we're worried about nuclear war and them getting the bomb, and
well, I mean, yeah, just the relationship between America and Cuba. You've got Cubans that are upset over his death. You have other Cubans, especially some that I was seeing on the news this morning in Florida, that were cheering over his death. I know, of course, for the past few years, he's not been in charge. It's been his brother, Raul.
Last 10 years, I believe, is what they said. Yeah.
And 10 years. But then I saw on the news this morning, which it'll be interesting to see how this goes, to make you wonder why. But then Raul said something about him stepping down in 2018, which
right,
now
his
makes
brother,
you,
his brother's yeah. going to step down from leadership of Cuba in 2018. Well, listen, Castro was 90.
Going?
Well, Castro's 90.
Right.
Was 90 when he died on Friday. I don't know how old Raul is, but he.
Well, he's not. Yeah, he's
no,
not
he's in
young.
His 80s, I right. believe. He's yeah. also in his 80s. I mean, they probably have tons of money as far as that goes. They can get anything that they want.
And even more now.
And even, yeah. And they know, and they look, they know at the end of the day, the revolution is over. Mm-hmm. You know, it's time to come into the 21st century. And so my guess, I don't know, that we'll start seeing true and comprehensive political elections to put in a present El Presidente down there, obviously, to be able to run that country. I think it's cool because that's a country that many of us have never been able to go to. And as you know, I like to travel. Country club I belong to is doing a trip in March, April, something like that, to Cuba. So you're starting to see Americans go down there now.
Well, I know the Des Moines Partnership last year had a trip to Cuba.
Yeah,
you know, right.
That's
after,
right. That's
they,
right.
They did. So a lot of local businessmen went down on a little tour there.
It's a time capsule. The reason I want to go there, it's
right.
a time capsule.
Oh, yeah. They're still driving, you know, like Chevy Bel Airs. I mean, these 50s cars.
50s
yeah.
and 60s cars, because all trade was stopped. And so all of these folks knew, hey, we got to take care of what we have. I wonder, is that a good signal? I wonder. Well, I read something that ties into this. Is it Switzerland or Sweden?
Somebody.
I think it was Sweden. They're now paying, the government is now paying individuals to fix stuff.
Really? So like cars, TVs?
Absolutely, whatever. Cell phone, whatever. If you will fix it rather than throw it away, then we will pay you a little something for doing that. In other words, it's teaching individuals how to take care of what they have. It's a clear signal, and it's a positive signal. I mean, the Cubans knew we are not getting a brand new Ford.
Right.
Okay? We've got this old Ford from 1952, and if we want to be driving 10 years from now, we're going to take care of this some good. I've never seen anything up close, but I've talked to people that have been there, and I've watched it on TV. Some of these vehicles are absolutely pristine.
Oh, yeah.
And then also their homes, the appliances.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know if you remember this, back in the 60s. I remember the appliances of the 60s, the hot pinks. That's all down there. I mean, it is a time capsule that throws back to the 50s and 60s. Period, the end. Are there cell phones down there? Sure. But it's still a throwback. It's a time capsule of the 50s and 60s. And I'm thrilled that relations have improved. And guess what? They began to improve, though Castro wasn't 100% on board with it. You can check that out. It was improving, and we can now travel there. For that, Mr. Obama, thank you. I mean, look, seriously, we're gonna have trade now. I'm a cigar smoker. Dadgum, at least now I can get my cigars without it going through third parties. Okay? Yeah, come arrest me. But the fact is, you can do that. So right. I like that. Now, here's the problem. Here's what I want to get to.
Okay.
There have been individuals, you're talking about some Cubans are happy, some Cubans are sad, in Cuba and in Florida in particular, because that's where many of them migrated to.
Well,
right?
And a lot of them in Florida are very happy because of the relations and being able to travel there. They can now travel back home.
They got family.
Right. They can see their family, or they can see, they can actually look at their ancestry, where they came from, if they're maybe second or third generation in the United States.
Absolutely. I mean, seriously, this opens a wonderful door. And that's why some people are very happy. Here's my challenge, and this just dadgummit just irks me to no end. It's the term called political correctness.
Mm-hmm.
Look, Fidel Castro was a thug.
Yeah,
he was a thug. Over 100,000 of his people died by his hand, maybe not directly, but clearly indirectly, and also directly, I'm certain.
Well, there's not just that. Look, remember, what was it, in the 80s, when he sent all those boats of the sick, the mentally handicapped, and all that, of Cubans, on the boats to Florida?
That's right. I do remember.
He sent, because you're talking like a 40-mile distance from Cuba to Florida.
Yeah, exactly. But that's true. And he did, getting them off of his land.
Exactly.
Yeah, saying, I don't want to deal with you.
Right.
I don't want to deal with you.
Right.
I don't want to create a better infrastructure of medicine and things like that. So, he
was a ruthless dictator.
He's a panty waste from the perspective of caring about people. I mean, he's no good. He's a scoundrel, was a scoundrel, was a thug, was a murderer. All of those things. And Raul, right there with him, same situation. Now, maybe Raul's probably part of the reasoning of the last 10 years, and clearly is the reasoning why relationships have improved between America and Cuba. But the man's a thug. He's a thug. And this political correctness crap, in my opinion, can go down the drain. Listen, one of the few things, perhaps, that I love about Donald Trump is the fact that he takes no prisoners. He does not color coat the pill that you're about to take. He just lays it out black and white. And I had it, so I'm not reading it. I'm not verbatim here, as they say. But here's the thing. He clearly identified Fidel Castro was a thug, killed hundreds of thousands or 100+ thousand people. And it is a wonderful day for the country of Cuba and for those Cubans that are now Americans that he is gone and relationships are improving. And now on to a truly better Cuba. While people like Mr. Obama, President Obama, placated, was politically correct, we are so saddened. Hell.
Oh, the two different tweets.
That's my point. That's exactly right. The fact is you've got people like Mr. Obama that is playing the political correctness card, I think is absolutely stupid. You know what it reminds me of? If Adolf Hitler were still alive, he would do the same thing for Adolf Hitler. I would question how many Jews would throw their hands up and say, "Oh Lord, oh Lord, what have you done?" But if it were Mr. Trump, he would let you know this is a man that killed millions of people. He's a worthless, no good scoundrel. However, thank God he's dead. Now we can work on developing positive relationships with these countries, with the good people that want to develop their country to be a better country, a safer country, and that type of thing. I applaud President Trump for what he said. I disapprove of what Mr. Obama said and several others that are on the record. I disapprove of this political correctness look, if you don't like me, Jimmy, tell me. Also, please tell me why.
Mm-hmm.
Because at the end of the day, I may not recognize it, but you're my friend. And the truth of the matter is, you need to tell me what you think.
Well, it's a lot of times when it comes...
Mr. Trump is a friend of the people, and he told everybody exactly who this hood was, and then said, now let's move forward.
Well, I mean, when you're dealing with the political correctness, I mean, there's just so many things that you cannot say, so many things that you cannot do. You're worried about stepping on someone's toe. I mean,
that's the problem, walking on eggshells all the time. Seriously?
They talk about tolerance, but then how can you tolerate if you're not able to really
tolerate
understand?
An opposite opinion?
Right.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Right.
Everybody wants to have an opinion until somebody gives them their opinion to you, then you want to run away.
Then it's political correctness, and everybody has to have the same opinion, and nobody can think.
I'm not going to pat you on the ass. I'm just not going to do that. I'm your friend. I am not going to pat you on the ass. There are things that you and I disagree on. I'm sure. I'm confident. But you know what? I'm not going to beat you around the head with a baseball bat. Neither am I going to be politically correct. I'm going to say, Jimmy, I don't agree with that. A minute ago, if there's something I was disagreeing with you on, okay?
I say every week, that's the way it is. There's something, right.
At the end of the day, this is healthy.
But the problem that we run into, and I know we've discussed it before, is being able to have that discussion, an adult discussion, being able to, you know, disagree without getting into a fight.
Well,
normally ends up happening.
Yeah, you seventh place people to get a first place prize need to have your asses kicked. Okay, you came in seventh, get a seventh place prize, and in fact, you don't even deserve a damn ribbon if you came in seventh place. But the point is, you're exactly right. We are destroying not only our country, but perhaps the world, because we have to be politically correct all the time. My mother doesn't like this. I'm going to tell you something. My mother doesn't like how Mrs. McRoberts and I interact at mm-hmm. times. And my mother's 83 years old. She comes cut from years ago, a cloth of you know, doing what is, comes from the greatest generation ever, quite frankly. But Mrs. McRoberts and I, we don't argue and raise our voices, mm-hmm. but we go tit for tat at each other.
Mm-hmm.
And we do that.
Kind of like a fire and ice type of thing.
Yeah. And sometimes it's fire and fire.
Well, right.
But the fact of the matter is, if she doesn't agree with me on something or something needs to be done, she's going to tell me. And guess what? I'm going to tell her.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the day, we ain't going to mince any words. And it's because we have a clear understanding that we're both directing ourselves to the bigger picture down the road. We're going to be together another 30, 40, 50 years, whatever that happens to be if I live that long. And we have to be a team. Mm-hmm. And team members don't placate each other. Team members work as a team. Whether it's a football team or a baseball team, you got a lineman to the right of you, the guard to the right of you, you know, the tackle to the left of you, and your guard didn't do a good job, that tackle might say, dude, you dumbass, Jimmy. You should have taken him out of the kneecaps, man. He about killed me, but I stopped him for you. Try this.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I just got in your face, said, you know, rather than go, Jimmy, you know, it's a tough day. I know it is. I know it's hot out here, and I know that you're not real strong. But buddy, you can do it. No, dumbass. Block the guy. Don't let me have to do your job. I wasn't mad at you, but I had to make a point. The political correct answer would not have been correct.
Well, the political correct answer, I mean, maybe starting with, depending on your tact of doing it, but it's not always giving you the answer of what you need to do.
Yeah.
It's like, you can do it. You'll be fine. Well, okay, I'll be doing it. I'll be fine. But what's the solution?
Yeah.
You tell me the problem.
Yeah.
Now, you know, what's the solution to that problem?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
How can we get to that? How can we do this
right,
better?
Right, right. Well, the whole world has become that, where they stop at the answer.
But the bottom line is you two are able to have that conversation. You're able to have the disagreements, but then yet still at the end of – I mean, we just came off of Thanksgiving.
Right.
And the two things whenever you read anything that you do not discuss during Thanksgiving are
– politics.
And
– religion.
Right. Because – for whatever the reason being, no one can have an adult conversation when it comes to either one of them. It has to turn into some knockdown, drag-out fight, mm-hmm. somebody getting torqued off, mm-hmm. stomping out the front door, mm-hmm. slamming doors, all because you have to be a child. You have to take your ball and go home because you do not agree, you do not see things the way I do.
Yeah.
Well, that's okay.
That's exactly what Pence said when he was booed at Hamilton. He said, it sounds like freedom to me. And you know what? That, again, gosh, what a great answer. Say whatever you want to about the guy. What a great answer. It is. However, we need to have individuals that grow up, mm-hmm. okay, that grow up and handle their business appropriately. That case maybe was a bad example for me to bring up, other than I think Pence did a nice job in his answer, but that's not the forum for that. And the other thing that people, this country is becoming despicable, okay? Mrs. Clinton, there are more deplorables in this country than you realize. For anybody to be in an
on
audience,
either side of the fence.
That's my point. That's exactly my point. The these people are on both sides of the fence. To have a public figure that just won the second highest office in the country, right, wrong, or indifferent, does not. I'm going to tell the folks a story in a minute. Mm-hmm. And does not condone them being rude.
Well, there's a friend of mine, and I mean, we see a lot of things kind of eye to eye, but for the most part, we also see things a little different. I mean, sure. they're a little more, I am an independent. I do not claim a side because both sides need to just get slapped and reworked because y'all a bunch of morons.
Yeah, I don't disagree with you.
But he has taken a side. Now, I mean, for years he was a Republican, but then he has moved over and he's become a Democrat.
Okay.
Of course, I would probably label him more as down south with what they call a blue dog Democrat, which sure. is somebody that's a lot more conservative, kind of like a
correct.
Or what I've been using with the whole Trump thing is more of a businessman Republican.
Sure. Sure. That's an interesting comment. I like that.
Because, you know, they when it comes to social issues and things, if you don't bother me, I don't care. It's not my problem. As long as you're not affecting me and my life, it's not my issue.
Right.
But if it's things, you know, when it comes to business, trade, you know, what when it's affecting my wallet, now I'm concerned.
Certainly.
So that's kind of how he thinks. So I mean, so like I said, for me, you would have the blue dog Democrat. You would have the businessman Republican, which they're a little more towards the center. Not very conservative, not very liberal, but they're there. But that's kind of how he thinks. So him and I have conversations all the time. We'll discuss politics. We'll discuss religion, which will drive his family insane
mm-hmm.
because we're having these conversations. But you know what? At the end of the day, him and I are still friends.
Certainly.
Do we see eye to eye on everything? No. Does he completely understand where I think? No. Now, I've got another friend that will almost refuse to have those conversations with me. Sometimes we'll kind of trip into having that conversation, but as quick as it starts, they try to change that conversation
sure.
because they're not able to see a level playing field of when it's all said and done. Basically, for them, it's kind of like, and they're again liberal. It's kind of what I use when it comes to Christianity of it's your way, you know, it's my way or the highway, which is not the way it's supposed to be because we need to tolerate, we need to love one another, and we need to take care of one another. It doesn't matter if we disagree. At the end of the day, if you need help, it should be. I should be helping you,
mm-hmm.
period. I mean, so it's interesting when you see how that works out of how people can have the adult conversations.
It's calling
not.
Having good manners.
Mm-hmm.
Don't change how you feel. I don't want you to. If you believe strongly in it, stand up for that. Mm-hmm. But there is a right way and a wrong way to do it. Getting back to, and those are all very valid points, getting back to treating people with respect. Look, I don't like Mrs. Clinton.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like Bill Clinton, but I sure as hell, if I'm in a situation where I'm going to go up and meet them, I am going to extend to them good common courtesy.
Well, we've even said it before. Now, you know, not that you agree with President Obama, but if he were to walk in, if you had the opportunity, and I even said the same thing, and there's some conservative friends of mine that it makes the hair on the back of their neck stand up. I go, if I had an opportunity to get my picture taken with the president,
I'd do it.
Absolutely.
I'd do it.
You just met the president of the United States.
Good, bad, or indifferent, you can spin it any way you want to, but he still is that. So, right. Whether it was the electoral vote, whether it was the popular vote, let's not get on that. But it doesn't matter. He made it. Two terms. This country felt that he was the man for the job. Mm-hmm. So you have to respect it, which gets to my story. World War II, I heard this story. I may have told this on some previous show that we had, but it bears repeating even if I did. And I'll get it as best as I can. But during World War II, there were a group of soldiers. There were a Frenchman, an Italian, maybe one from Australia, and an American. Mm-hmm. These four men were viewing the Vatican. Okay, they were in Rome, and they were going through the Vatican, walking through the halls, looking at the paintings and all the beautiful work that was done there. And all of a sudden, a huge entourage comes through what I would call a lobby of some mm-hmm. sort. And towards the middle of it was the Pope at that time. Forgive me, all you Catholics out there, which I am not one. You probably would know who was the Pope during Second World War, but was walking through, and all of these soldiers stood at a line, stood up as the Pope came to the first one, the Italian, the Frenchman, mm-hmm. that, and each time, now this is standard practice, and seriously, please understand what I'm about to say. He would extend his hand, mm-hmm. they get on their knees and kneel and kiss the ring. I disagree with that. He's a man, okay? Mm-hmm. Paul said stand up. You know, you don't kneel to me, okay? Mm-hmm. And I understand. I don't mean to hurt anybody's feelings out there, but I wouldn't do it. But having said that.
Well, I was going to say, because when he was president, Bush, when he met the Pope, he did that and then actually ended up getting criticism.
Yeah, I wouldn't do it. Well, to finish the story.
Right.
So each one of these, the Frenchman, the Italian, the Australian, whatever, went to the last person, mm-hmm. and this gentleman did not take the Pope's hand. He stood straight back, did attention, gave him a solid military salute, and stood there. And the Pope looked at him, and I'm sure he probably had to have an interpreter. He said, you're an American, aren't you? He said, yes, sir. Texas, sir. The Pope understood that that man just gave him full and complete respect mm-hmm. without having to bend his knee and kiss somebody's finger, as far as that goes. Now, you may want to spin that as he was impolite, but as I understand the story, the Pope understood. He looked at him and said, American. And he said, yes, sir. Texas, sir. In other words, we don't bow to anybody in this country. We don't bow to anybody. We are the ones that have changed this world the last 250 years. We're the ones that are the preeminent leader in the world, or should be the preeminent leader. We're the ones that don't back away from a fight. Okay? If you think the Irish have that cornered, you're wrong. Specifically because we got a whole bunch of Irish-born folks that fill this country up, and we'll fight you. And we'll fight you hands down. And you know what? That's what makes us great. We're not afraid. Look, when 9/11 hit, we had never seen a rush of men and women that wanted to sign up and be a part of our military. I still believe every young man and young woman should do at least 2 years, should be a requirement just like it is in Israel. But we had never seen a rush like that since World War II, I believe. People were rushing to the recruiting stations. Why? Because they were pissed. They knew that this was wrong. And by God, they were going to stand up. There's NFL football players. Can't remember the one young man's name. He gave up a career as a professional football player, making dad good money and could sleep on nice sheets every night to do what? To go over and do two tours, and I believe in his second tour he was killed. But he was willing to do that. And yet we have, this is Rooster's rant, I guess. Yet we have universities like up in New Hampshire, I believe it was, that the university and the administration of the university agreed to withdraw all American flags from the property. How dare you disrespect my country? How dare you little sniveling-ass brats, especially you administration, weak, suck, crybaby pee-pants academia individuals would do that to me. And guess what? Hundreds, if not thousands, of veterans went to that university, flags in hand. Not to beat anybody up. There was one slight altercation, but nobody, no fights. We're talking about a group of men and women, veterans, with their flags saying, look, we want you to understand that we applaud your freedom of speech, but we also want you to understand what the hell it took and what we did and what price we and many of us in this group and some that can't be with us today did to give you the damn right and opportunity to be a part of this university and get a great education to improve not only yours, but your families and your family's families' future. By God, at least buck up and give some respect to the dadgum flag that flies over this country and quit this bullshit of going out there and saying, I'm hurt. I need a fucking I need a safe place. Listen to me. I'm telling you. I'm so sick of you weak-ass bastards. It's pissing me off. And I'm serious about this. No. I'm reliving parts of the 60s where you stupid-ass hippies back then would take flags and burn them or pee on them, and it's coming back again. And I'm telling you, it did nothing but destroy our country for 10, 15, 20 years, 30 years. We're finally getting things back together. Now we're doing the same thing again. Stop it. Stop it. Look, men and women died to protect those freedoms. I, with those veterans, applaud the fact that they have the right. You know, it's the voice of freedom. But what I'd like for you to add to it is a little common sense. What I'd like for you to add to it is a little respect. It's all those veterans were asking for. Show us a little respect. Until you've had bullets zinging past your head, or stood in line going up a beach or a hill or in a jungle and see your friend on the right, his head blown up like a watermelon getting blown up, and his brains all over your arms and your legs. See, it ain't pretty. It ain't nice. That was your best friend you had a beer with the night before. Now his brains are all over the front of your uniform, and you got to keep moving forward. The guy to your right gets hit mid-drift, and his guts are hanging out on the ground, and you're trying to shove them back in to try to save your best friend's life while bullets and bombs are going around you. Until you've had your sorry ass in that position, you better sure as hell respect the men and women that have been in that position. Do a little research in history. That's all I got to say about it.
Well,
I'm sorry.
The other side of that, though, is which we've talked about before, and a lot of times when it comes to the protesting, that they're being bullies when they're out there and then attacking. When, again, you're fighting against bullies, but then yet you're attacking someone who does not agree with you. That's still a bully.
Still a bully. Verbally and physically, that's how these bullies are out there. Mm-hmm. Look, I you know
if
what?
You need to tolerate me.
It's a two-way street, baby.
Right.
It's a two-way street. Listen, I said it, but I'm retracting. I said, I'm sorry I went on that rant. You know what? I'm not one damn bit sorry.
You're not sorry that you went on the rant. You just are probably sorry of how far you...
All right. So my listen, folks, I'm just a tad bit colorful. I just want to make my point, and sometimes profanity fits. Fits.
You're listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster, thanks to Dead Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool. Sorry.
That's
to
right.
Virtually put your home or business finances on autopilot. DebtProdigy.com. Sorry, things like that. It just, you know what? I don't know. It just makes me laugh. Why does it make me laugh? I don't know. It's either you're going to laugh or you're going to cry. I don't know. I've been around long enough that I don't know. I don't even know. Here's what I do know.
Tell me something that you need.
I know. Here's what I know. I know this. Nicolas Cage chose his last name from the superhero Luke Cage.
Yeah. That I didn't know, actually.
Because his real last name is Coppola.
Yeah, it's a Coppola. Yeah.
Yeah. Because his uncle's Francis Ford Coppola, yep. The director of The Godfather.
Yep.
So there you go. There's a psychological theory called Blue 7 Phenomenon.
A psychological theory.
It's called the Blue 7 Phenomenon, where the average person will say their favorite color is blue and their favorite number is 7. What? But they haven't figured out why blue and 7 are so popular. But with this phenomenon, if your favorite color is blue, your favorite number is 7. So it's the blue 7 phenomenon.
Do you have a favorite number? I don't have a favorite number.
I don't. I've got colors, yes. Numbers, yeah. Not that I can think of.
Why would somebody have a favorite number? Okay, here's my favorite number: $25 million. $25 million is the number. Put a dollar sign in front of it. I have a favorite number. There's my number. Other than that, I don't know why anybody would have a favorite number. Now, if they said, "What's your favorite color?" and choose a number. Does the mind go to 7 most of the time? I don't know.
Well, I mean, like for me, I don't know that I have a favorite number, but there's certain things that, I mean, I guess you could call it like an OCD thing. If I go get cottage cheese, I will do like 5 dips. I mean, there's certain things that I'll do that I do a certain number. I'm not really saying that that's my favorite
number.
We're
finding out very strange things about Reverend
Jim. Oh, I'm strange, man. I can tell you that right now. Okay, here's something strange. Is the island Montserrat? Is that how you say the Caribbean?
Montserrat. Okay. Yeah.
So
Montserrat.
The capital of the island Montserrat in Caribbean is a ghost town.
Really?
Yeah. The city Plymouth was abandoned after a volcano destroyed it, most of it, in 1995, but it's still the capital city.
Still the capital city.
Yeah.
That's a good place to send Arnold, you know. He had California. Send him there.
Here's something interesting. Osama bin Laden's father and brother both died in a plane crash.
I don't know why I heard that someplace, but yeah, that's interesting. Did we shoot it down or is it just
Paul
Harvey, what's the rest of the story?
Seriously. Okay, so Oreos are a knockoff of Hydrox cookies. Do you know what Hydrox cookies are?
I have no idea what a Hydrox cookie is.
I have no idea, but they say they are the knockoff of Hydrox cookies, not vice versa, because Hydrox cookies debuted in 1908 and Oreos debuted in 1912.
And they're both basically...
Yes.
Evidently, you can get Hydrox cookies at Walmart, dude.
Yeah, I think now today those are like the generic versions of the Oreo, but technically
they sell
the Oreo. No, I know, but I think they're actually cheaper than Oreos. So when you're buying them, they're the generic version of the Oreo. But technically, Oreo, even though they are more expensive, would be the generic version of Hydrox.
Did you say 1908?
Yeah.
Manufactured Sunshine Biscuits. Was the company?
You still see them. They have the Sunshine logo on the package.
Yeah.
You've seen that Sunshine logo. I think it's like Sunshine Bakery now.
Yeah.
So then it was Sunshine Biscuits. Now I think it's like Sunshine Bakery.
All right. Newport Beach based Leaf Brands, which is what you meant. Compared to Oreos, Hydrox cookies have a tangy. There's a difference. Hydrox cookies have a tangy, less sweet filling. And a crunchier cookie that gets less soggy in milk.
Interesting.
So there is a difference, and as you said, Oreo did the knockoff after the fact. Okay, fair enough. But there's taste different.
Right.
So it is basically visually perhaps a similar looking cookie, but
texture and taste is
going to be a little different.
Interesting.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
All right, and then we're going to leave you for this Thanksgiving. This is interesting. A 5-year-old called 911 on Thanksgiving Day. They were the parents gave him a cell phone to play with that, you know, was turned off. But of course, you know, it was deactivated, but you can still dial 911 even from a deactivated cell phone.
That's exactly right.
So he ends up calling 911, but it was not an emergency call. Here was the message that he left. It was about 10 seconds. He said to he was asking police to come over because his family was having Thanksgiving dinner. So he called them to invite police to come over and have Thanksgiving dinner with them. Of course, when mom found out, little upset, he got in trouble. But not long after, you know, him getting his little talking to, two police officers did show up just to make sure everything was okay. They did not end up having, you know, dinner with them at
all. They didn't charge him or anything.
But they didn't charge him. Yeah. But they said, this is what they said. They said that that phone call was the best thing that happened to them all day.
It's just wonderful.
They gave him a little sheriff's badge before they left, and they let him play with the siren in the car.
That's cute.
In fact, then before they left, the kid's name was Billy. Billy said that he wants to be a cop when he grows up so he can, quote, be nice to little kids like they were.
That's wonderful. I think that's wonderful. That's wonderful. And the parents let him know it wasn't the right thing to do, and here's why.
Right.
And then the respect, then it shows the respect. These two police officers handled it absolutely right. They weren't Barney Fifes. Mm-mm. They handled it right. God bless them. That's wonderful.
You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. Thanks to DebtProdigy.com. DebtProdigy helps you track all your spending and expenses. Create and manage your budget. Manage all your financial account. And DebtProdigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time. DebtProdigy.com. Rooster, until next time, sir. Always a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Same here, my friend. Thank you. See you next Monday.
The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster.